It is really a great pleasure to be here and really a wonderful, wonderful opportunity to speak with you. And I really look forward to talking about these issues. I will, during the course of our conversation, want to talk a bit about your personal background and what it is that led you into reporting, the impact that you perhaps perceive that your Jewishness, being raised in a home that was Zionist in orientation, may have had on your reporting. But I want the focus principally to be really on how you perceive the situation in Israel right now, given your reporter's experience, the breadth of articles that you've written on, and certainly the events of the last several years. Do you think that we are now experiencing a third intifada, or to phrase it differently, what is your analysis of the current situation?
Thanks, Rabbi Ellenson. It's great to be back at the JCC, and thank you to Rabbi Levitt and Ayelet and to Nadia for inviting me back and helping put together such a great event, and thank you all for coming to hear us. Those of you who've heard me speak before may have heard me talk about how I think sometimes it feels like events or news in Israel and the Palestinian territories, I sort of see it like a spinning top and a lot of stuff happening and moving very quickly in a very also competitive journalistic environment, local journalistic environment, and that I see it as my job as a reporter to sort of figure out whether the top is moving in any direction, and that I often suggest to audiences that it's their job as people who want to be active in the situation or the conflict or in Israel to try to move the top in a certain direction. But sometimes it has felt over my time there that a lot of things happen and very little changes. And as I'm preparing now, you may have heard, I'm preparing now to leave Jerusalem on January 1st. I'm starting a new job here in New York on the international desk as an editor, and obviously reflecting a lot on, right, on my time. And I now really think that this sort of issue of a lot happening and nothing changed has changed. And I think that in the time I've been there, things have changed on the underlying situation. And what we're seeing now since October 1st, and to some extent over the last year and a half since the collapse of the Kerry talks, the kidnappings of the three Israeli teenagers, right, and then Mohammed Abu Khdair, and then the Gaza War, and then really a year of violence in Jerusalem and elsewhere that was connected in some way to concerns about the Temple Mount, all of which is sort of crescendoed now in the last 8 weeks of very deadly attacks and serious crackdowns by the Israeli security forces, I do think represents a shift in the situation, in the underlying situation. We can talk a little bit more about some of those
and
factors.
And how would you define that, what the shift is in specific terms? I am curious to know, too, I mean, do you see the events in Gaza in particular as significant in leading to this shift as you define it? And do you think that what we're now experiencing represent copycat attacks, or would you say that this is really part of some larger concerted kind of effort?
Well, first of all, let me go back to the original question about is this an intifada. I think to some extent we journalists and I guess activists too, and some government officials and security officials have spent quite a lot of time debating that, and I think mostly it's the wrong question. I mean, I think certainly something...
I'm glad that the first question was the wrong one. Now we'll get to the right
one. No, and it's not... I mean, you're certainly not the only one asking it. And what I mean by that is that I think... I mean, Intifada has always had... we translate it as uprising. That's not really the direct translation. The first and second intifadas were quite different from each other, and if we want to call this the third intifada, it is also quite different. It is... I don't think it's either an orchestrated thing, certainly not orchestrated by some leaders, or only a matter of copycat attacks. I mean, I guess copycat might be the right word for it. I mean, it seems to be a series of individuals, mostly young people, mostly from Hebron, almost all no security background, no connection with political groups, And most of them, there was a new article out today about a study by the Internal Security Service of Israel. I think they said 59% of them or something had not planned it at all. Mostly they find out either from interviewing the ones who live and are arrested or from talking to family members and friends. They seem to decide that day or the day before. Many of them have been inspired by either specific or general Facebook and other social media posts and incitement. Many of them don't tell anyone what they're doing. Some of them have left suicide notes or last wills or whatever. They clearly know they expect to die. For some of them, that's a motivation. They see being a martyr as a honored position in society that is enhanced and enforced by the leadership. And I think, you know, we can spend, it's important to think about what's going on here, both because of the incredible challenge it presents to Israel's security service, much bigger challenge in a lot of ways than the far deadlier versions in the past, because while the numbers of people who have been killed by these attackers is relatively low, the kind of amount of fear they're able to foment by the randomness and the inability of the security services to figure out how to stop it is a serious problem. So that's one thing. I also think that understanding the lack of organization is important, and also the desperation that kids are showing, that they're completely willing to die even for inflicting relatively little damage other than a psychological damage on the society is something we have to examine and try to understand, because it's part of this larger situation. And I guess at the risk of going on a little too long for the question, when I talk about the connections between the collapse of the Kerry talks and the kidnappings and the Gaza war and the Temple Mount and the latest uprising, it's not necessarily that it's a linear causation relationship, but I think all of them are braided together, I guess, if you want to understand the situation. And they did feed each other to this larger sense that I have of change in I guess, the following way. I think the situation has gotten worse and progressed negatively in the time I've been there, in kind of two ways. I mean, one is that between the Gaza war and this fall, there's a lot more violence than there was in 2012. So that's the first thing. But the bigger, more concerning thing, I think, is the devolution in the debate, in the perceptions of each other. We saw during the three Israeli teenagers,
right,
and then the Palestinian from Shuafat, the twin sort of kidnapping killings, this kind of horrific dehumanization of the other, and then in the surrounding debate, the same. And I think that has continued. And we have just after 10 years, after the kind of separation barrier has gone up, the end of the second Intifada, we have very little day-to-day contact between the two societies. And a real kind of, as I said, dehumanization and a increasing lack of hope on both sides of anything good ever happening here, any solution coming out of it. And I think for Israel and for American Jews who care about Israel, that another layer of that, of what's changed in the last 2 years, is the isolation that Israel's facing internationally. And I think all of those things together, you know, need to make people who love Israel and care about Israel ask themselves the hardest question of all, which is, how long is this sustainable?
How do you, when you in fact write your articles, and I know that this isn't principally, as Rabbi Cohen said, a discussion about how news itself is created, but rather we're attempting to focus principally on how you assess the situation. But from an academic's point of view, the major issue that we always confront is, what's the narrative framework going to be, and in fact, what is the question? Because in fact, once you determine the question, that will in part shape the narrative that's going to unfold in any academic article, book, et cetera, that you write. And, you know, as you were just speaking, so you alluded very casually to the reality that with the construction of the security fence or the wall, however one separation barrier, that there was, of course, less contact then between Israeli Jews and Palestinian Arabs. But often then, let's say if you're reporting on a situation in the year 2015, how is it that you in fact begin to contextualize whatever the narrative is? Because one of the issues in trying to even understand the situation is how far back, so to speak, does the narrative go? And often when I read articles in the Times, I think to myself, well, this is a description of exactly what happened at one singular moment, but it leaves out certain contextual factors that led to this event occurring. So I just wondered how you make such decisions when you go about the task of reporting.
So this is a great question. Sorry to criticize earlier.
Okay.
No.
I'm trying, you know, as we keep going on, I make it
funny.
Better.
It's so. Very funny. So, I mean, I'm constantly having people who I'm interviewing saying, that's a really good question. I'm thinking, yes, that's what I do for a living, and I've done it well. So look, sometimes in hearing people's criticism, it feels to me like every article needs to contain a paragraph that said, Abraham had two sons, there was Isaac and there was Ishmael. And that is like the nut graph of everything I write. And I actually did manage to get the sons of Ishmael and sons of Isaac in a piece a couple of weeks ago about this hummus place that's offering half off to mixed tables of Arabs and Jews.
Yes.
If you read that.
Yeah, it was great.
So that I got to check that off my list before I left. But anyway, this question of how much context and background is a critical question, and it is a critical part of journalistic responsibility and decision making, and it has to do a lot with who we're writing for at any given moment. Of course, we're writing for many different audiences at the same time. So, you know, and space is tight, and we are competing with all sorts of other articles and mediums for people's attention. So my biggest goal, I would guess I have two sets of goals. One, to answer the beginning of your question of what are we doing here, my job is to explain what happened and why it matters and what does it mean. That's what I'm trying to do all of the time. And context is important in that. But I'm not trying to tell people the history of Israel and Palestine in every 800-word article, definitely not. And the other thing I'm really trying to do is get people who read the first sentence to read the second sentence, and get people who read the second sentence to read the third sentence. And so I have to, and that relates both to putting in background and context and to keeping it out. Because what I'm trying to do is answer people's questions as they have them and not bore them or distract them at all at the same time. And I'm doing that for both the, you know, person in Bangladesh who reads one article a month about Israel-Palestine, and for you who, you know, is on 17 listservs about Israel-Palestine.
I'm only laughing about this because I have actually one non-Jewish friend, and he claims, actually I have a couple, but one of them actually claims to me that there are people who get up every morning, lead their lives, make love, make war, do all these sorts of things, and he claims
that
they don't think even one moment about Jews or the state of Israel. I, by the way, don't believe that's true, but he makes that claim. So you're writing really for a broad audience.
Right, and I think, I mean, if I have to choose between writing for people who will come to an event like this and who have many, many sources of news about this place, and writing for people who will only know what's happening in the Middle East if they read what I write, and there are more of them.
Right.
If I had to choose, I would choose the other people. I'm sorry. I appreciate that you came. I'm not trying to insult you. I do appreciate it. But I know you don't really need me, and I know that most of you don't actually read what I write in order to find out what's going on. You read it for other reasons or in other ways. But I think that, you know, the folks in Nebraska and Nepal, like, really need to know what's going on in Israel-Palestine, too. And I need to make sure that I give them exactly as much context as they need to understand it fairly and fully, but not to go over things just for the sake of having put them in, so that the activists will feel better about the scorekeeping that they're doing. And I'll give you an example where both sides of critics had what I thought were sort of bizarre requests for what should be in stories. And it was about a year ago, maybe more than a year ago now, definitely before Harnof, but people don't really remember during the current uprising, but really there was a whole wave of Jerusalem violence last September, October of 2014 that was also kind of connected to the Temple Mount controversy. And we were writing quite a bit about the Temple Mount at that time, too. And you might remember Israel closed the Temple Mount fully for a day. Jordan pulled its ambassador. It was quite a big deal. So I got a number of Israel activists who were very upset that our kind of day-to-day stories on what was happening did not include the fact that Jordan didn't allow Jews to go to the Old City between 1948 and 1967. Right. And then I got a lot of Palestinian activists who were very upset that our articles did not routinely say that Palestinians in the West Bank and Gaza are not allowed to freely go to pray at Al-Aqsa. Now, both of those things are true. I just did not get what they would be doing in a story about what happened today in the Temple Mount controversy, because, and my understanding of why each side wanted those sentences in these stories was not because they would help them understand these stories, but because they would be a point on their side of the ledger, that if for the pro-Israel people, if we would put in that Jordan was mean to Jews 40 years ago, that that would make whatever Israel was doing about closing the Temple Mount today like seem less bad, because there'd be a point on the other side of the ledger. And similarly, that it was a problem to talk about. It was a problem to talk about Israel's restrictions on Palestinian access by age without mentioning that these other Palestinians who are not allowed in Jerusalem routinely without a permit at all are also not allowed to pray at the mosque. It's just, it seemed to me to be completely crazy, and it seemed to me it would be very confusing for the Nebraska-Nepal people who were trying to figure out what happened yesterday.
Yeah, of course, it also indicates that if one wants, how should I put it, all the news, so to speak, and understand it, that clearly there are, there is still some justification for people writing history as opposed to journalism.
So when I was asked this question from December of 2012, I guess until the second Gaza war I covered started, I would say to people, what started the 2012 Gaza war? And I mean, we could do this little exercise. Does anyone remember what started that war? So the first answer people would give was Israel assassinated the Hamas leader, whose name is escaping me right this second, which is not really true. That's not really what started the war, because about 3 days before that, there was an attack on some army jeeps outside, I think it was southern Gaza, I think it was outside Rafah, and a few days before that, there was something else, and there were some rockets in the previous month, and so we would do this exercise where we would go back five events over the course of a few months, and then somebody would say, well, in 1967, Israel occupied Gaza and the West Bank. Well, in 1948, Israel was created. Well, in the 20s, there were the riots, and you know, you get to Isaac and Ishmael pretty soon. So yeah. I think, you know, it's the crux of my job, but the answer is not to put all the background in. The answer is to make careful selections. And I think about it all the time. And so, I engage with many of you about my, you know, incorrect assessments all the time.
So leaving your incorrect assessments aside for a moment, we'd like to hear your views. You're obviously stationed in Jerusalem, but I think all of us would be very interested to hear how you perceive the relationship between Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Obama. Is it a fight over settlements, Iran? I mean, clearly we could name any number of areas where these two men have not agreed with one another, but what would your assessment be of their relationship? And I would be curious to know how you might compare it to other relationships between Prime Ministers of the State of Israel and Presidents of the United States. After all, Ambassador Oren makes the claim that there's never been this kind of cleavage, this kind of gulf between an Israeli and an American leader. I'm just curious to know what your own assessment then of this relationship is between these two specific men, and then for you to reflect even further on what you think the long-term implications of this will be.
Well, it's not good. They are not, I do not think that Obama will, you know, in January 2017 go to Caesarea for a weekend retreat. It is, I'm told by the historians and the experts, it's the worst kind of that anybody's seen, I guess. And that's, but I think that the smart and insightful people, I think, see maybe three strands of this. The first is the perennial tension and disconnect that is inherent even in very close friends and allies,
right.
Based on the difference between being the world superpower and being the lonely democracy in the Middle East. And, you know, if you want to use Sharon's line of what you see from here, you don't see from there. That's also true that what you see from the White House is just totally different from what you see from Jerusalem. And so those differences have been there throughout, I think, since 1948. And I think all Israeli prime ministers and presidents have had some tension. And there's you know, a lot of other sources you consult about the, you know, Shamir and Bush and other people who've had fights. The second thing is that there are some particularly fundamental ideological disagreements between these two guys, most principally over Iran, but really over many things, and certainly over the Arab Spring. And you know, I mean, really, Obama's whole response to the Middle East is something that Netanyahu just completely does not respect or get. And then there is the component that is personal in the way that somewhat because of their own doing and somewhat because of circumstances, they've gotten made it worse over the years. Peter Baker and I just did a big sort of look back at all of their interactions before their most recent meeting, and it was really interesting to remember and re-go over their first meeting.
And what was that?
Which was in 2007 when Obama was really just emerging. Hillary was definitely still the favorite in the Democratic presidential nomination then, and they... one of them was coming into Washington and one of them was going out, and they had a hastily arranged meeting at National Airport. And I spoke to someone who was there, two people who were there actually, and it was really interesting because it was a little unclear why they should even have this meeting. Neither of them, Netanyahu was the leader of the opposition, Obama was probably not going to be president, and why were they having this meeting? But their staffs convinced them to do it. They said, well, you might need to work together someday, blah, blah. And the meeting was apparently Obama really playing the kind of eager student with the sort of former prime minister, and it was all about Iran. And he was apparently quite respectful, and they were very much in agreement at that time because Obama was pushing legislation about to divest state pension funds from Iran, and Netanyahu, of course, was very supportive of that. Netanyahu is a great expert on Iran, so he was sort of schooling him a bit. And when he walked out of the meeting, Netanyahu said to his aides, that guy's going to beat Hillary, and he could be president.
Wow.
And he really had this sense of he's got, and the guy who told me the story said, you know, it takes one to know one kind of thing. Takes a really good politician to see that spark in someone, because the other guys were like on their Blackberries the whole time, not, you know, basically not paying attention to this guy. And they had another kind of pretty positive meeting the next year when he was the nominee and he came to visit Jerusalem. And then it went downhill from there. And you guys all know this story. I mean, you know about what happened when Biden came, and then the Ramat Shlomo was announced at the same time, and everyone got very upset about that. You know about Netanyahu not getting kind of fair warning about the statement in the Cairo speech regarding the 67 lines, and then him, you know, about Netanyahu lecturing him in the Oval Office. So none of those things helped. I think another factor that is often underlooked is the way that hardline Republicans here, who are staunchly pro-Israel and very supportive of Netanyahu and who agree with Netanyahu on a lot of things, have a separate political agenda about Obama, which is basically, you know, make Obama look bad at any cost, and have used Israel and used Netanyahu to further that aim. And I don't think he's been an unwitting participant, but there's a lot of that going on, and there was a lot of that in the whole issue of the speech in March.
Do you think that their relationship is at all improving in recent weeks?
No, not in any substantive way. They're going to, you know, Israel's going to get a big military compensation package post-Iran,
right.
And they're going to be fine getting through the end, and Obama's, you know, given up on doing the peace process, and, you know, they're not going to, I don't think they're going to have any more big public blowouts, although you never know. And as you also know, you know, Netanyahu's friends are very helpful by, I mean, his friends in Israel, his ministers, you know, right. They like to say mean things about Kerry and Obama as often as possible. So I'm not saying there won't be more crises. I've written many, many stories about the Washington-Jerusalem crisis. I expect I and my successor will write many more, but I don't think it is, no, the relationship is not improving. It's just quieting.
Do you think, since you mentioned the Cairo speech, and you did mention in general the whole way in which the world looks differently when you sit in D.C. and when you sit in Jerusalem, but having said that, and even with your comment, let's say, about the Republicans who use this as an issue for perhaps certain political ends.
Not exclusive of not their substantive goal. I mean, they really do want to support Israel and really do want to oppose the Iran deal, but they don't mind if Obama fails in the meanwhile.
No, that would be true. But I guess here, how would you describe really what their principal difference is? Because between President Obama and Prime Minister Netanyahu, and how might you specifically describe how they view the world so differently?
Well, let's start first with Iran. Yes. I mean, they share the same basic goal of Iran not obtaining a nuclear weapon, but for completely different reasons. For Obama, this is all about nonproliferation.
Right.
He's interested in Israel's security, but he does not. That is not the beginning and end for him. And Obama, while he said the nuclear accord was not about normalizing relations with Iran, he's happy to, he would like to see Iran return to the, you know, world of of agreeable nations. Netanyahu sees the nuclear threat as entirely, I mean, he sees it as both an existential threat to his own country's security as well as to upsetting the balance in the Middle East and around the world. He has no interest in Iran returning to any kind of relations with anybody as long as it continues to sponsor terrorism around the world. You know, Obama specifically said this accord is not about Iran's sponsorship of terrorism around the world. For Netanyahu, it became all about that.
Right.
So that's one thing. And I think there certainly, you know, their understanding of what's been happening in the last 5 years in the Middle East are very,
in
very
relationship
different.
To the Arab Spring.
Correct.
And which, where does ISIS fit in here?
Well, it's, I mean, they agree about ISIS, I think. But I think that they do not necessarily agree about how to fight ISIS. But again, you know, Netanyahu was asked just the other day about what Israel's role should be and also whether America and France should put boots on the ground. You know, it's not the same question for the Prime Minister of Israel or for the President of the United States. What should you do about ISIS? I mean, the President of the United States is thinking about, should I risk thousands of American lives by putting boots on the ground to fight ISIS? And the Israelis are not. So it's just a totally different worldview. But I think, you know, not just Netanyahu, but really many, many people in Israel have been very frustrated with Obama's kind of what they see as a very schizophrenic foreign policy towards the Middle East and towards the Arab Spring. And they were, I think Obama really lost a lot of people in Israel in the summer of 2013 when he set this red line about chemical weapons in Syria and said they're going to attack and then said, I'm going to ask Congress, and then said, we're not going to attack. And it was just a profoundly un-Israeli way of acting. And I think that it, as a metaphor for the whole years of policy, helps people understand what the different worldviews are.
Do you think there is any possibility that a two-state solution will ever be genuinely realized?
Wow. Yes.
Okay, and I'm just curious as to why, or why not, but in this case, why?
Well, because if it's not, then I don't think that that Israel will survive as a democracy and a Jewish state. So I think a lot of people want it to survive as a democracy and a Jewish state. Most of the most powerful people in the world want that.
I just wanted to hear it from your
lips. No, but I think that's the choice. And people, I think people forget that that's the choice. I don't think it's a choice between what's happening today and a two-state solution. I think it's a choice between a two-state solution and another chapter in history where the Jews ruled the Holy Land for a while.
Good. I just wanted to hear your views on that. You know, obviously, your position is one that is on occasion praised, but often critiqued from different sides. I don't know if you're aware that there have been people critical of how the New York Times covers events in the Middle East in general, and Israel in particular. And you've had two stories, and I want to mention a third that you didn't write. But one question concerns headlines. Another concerns a substantive issue with which you dealt. So I want to talk about the one where you offered a description, and I am just quoting you here, of the knife that was used in a stabbing attack, in quotes, as a Boy Scout knife, which, as we all know, has kind of a wholesome connotation, and that was extremely disturbing to many Jewish leaders. And here was the correction then that was written. An earlier version of this article referred imprecisely to the knife in the Israel police photo. It is a butterfly knife, which is traditionally used as a weapon. The Boy Scouts of America does not explicitly ban such knives. It endorses pocket knives for general use and does not sell butterfly knives in its official scout shop. Okay. I've learned more about butterfly.
How much research went into this correction?
Butterfly knives are legal in some states, and knife policies are set by individual troops. So it is possible, though unlikely, that some troops approve them. But the knife pictured is not typically the kind Boy Scouts use. So let me ask you, one, who writes this kind of correction, one? And two, what was it that you did intend when you used the term Boy Scout knife?
I should say that the article was 700 words. I think the correction is 300 words. So
we'll count it later.
So,
by the way, I couldn't have quoted it had it not been written down in its totality. So.
Well, I think it's important that you read it, and it's important that to say and to know that the New York Times corrects every error of fact that we are made aware of,
right,
or that we discover ourselves. And we do it vigorously and take it very seriously, and much more seriously than any other news organization ever in history,
right,
as far as I know. I'll have to issue a correction if I'm proved otherwise.
Right.
We in the Jerusalem Bureau spend a considerable amount of time figuring out if we have made an error of fact and making sure to correct it.
Right.
And in this case, actually, we had some help from the research staff here in New York. So that's the answer on sort of how the correction works. And the writing of corrections is an art form that is perfected by a whole staff of people. There's a guy named Greg Brock, who's kind of in charge of corrections over the whole paper. Each desk has its own corrections editor, who not only reviews every correction and makes sure there's this whole thing about whether you try not to repeat the mistake and using certain language. It's really very difficult to get it right. And they also track how the error was made, who made the error,
right,
and all of that. How did this error happen?
Right.
So this was a part of something I wrote once a month called Letter from the Middle East. It ran on, it's primarily an international New York Times print animal, which is a very small percentage of our report is that. But every day on page 2 of the international New York Times, there is a 700-word letter from somewhere, and I write it once a month. So the story was about the way that in a conflict that has always been very much defined by dueling narratives, this latest uprising was being kind of perceived and talked about in really different ways in the two societies, and that included a lot of just blatant lies being told by leaders to their people and by the people to each other. That's what the story was about. And so one of the examples that I was using was about when I went to cover, I happened to be near the Damascus Gate when an attack broke out, and I kind of went over there, and there was this crowd gathering, and they were kind of all talking about what they'd seen and what they didn't acknowledge seeing and what they'd heard and what had happened. You know, they all said they'd seen this kid running away from his father after an argument. None of them knew what the argument was about. None of them saw a knife. They insisted that if there was a knife, it had been planted. Sure enough, there was a knife, and the police sent out a picture of the knife, and it is a, if you know what a butterfly knife is, I'm sorry I don't have the picture here, but it's a folding knife. I mean, it has a, and the short answer of what happened is two things. I do not know very much about knives, and I was trying to write a writerly phrase in what is a column-y kind of more writerly form. I did not intend it to make it seem, I mean, I do think it is important that these attacks are being carried out with kind of every kind of sharp object you can imagine, that there have been, well, a lot of the kind of inciting videos and stuff show big daggers and meat cleavers, and there has been, both at Harnof and then again on in Geula on the street, there has been a meat cleaver. Most of them are carried out with really common kitchen knives, and some with scissors, one with screwdriver, another with scissors just the other day, and a number of Swiss Army knife kinds of things. To me, that is an important thing to know because it goes to what I was talking about before in terms of lack of planning, lack of sophistication, impossibility of stopping. I mean, it's very difficult. You know, there were all these roadblocks set up in East Jerusalem at one point, and I was thinking, yeah, because once they get through the roadblock, they can't go get a knife at any store. And, you know, Rami Levy at one point pulled the knives down from their shelves so they stopped selling knives. But the level of which, I think if anything, I was trying to evoke the kind of pathetic range of weapons, of grabbing anything that you can. I was certainly not trying to say the kid was a Boy Scout. That didn't occur to me until this uproar. It was a very poor choice of phrase, both because it was wrong and also because it left that impression. So I do regret that choice. And it was a choice made, I mean, really close to 100% for writing reasons, which is not a very good reason.
How do you determine, in light of what you just said, that there can be, and in fact probably often are, fabrications when you in fact interview people? So when you're there on the scene and you're beginning to interview, and people, of course, are claiming, for example, if we just stick to this instant case, you know, well, there was no knife, you know, and the boy couldn't therefore have possibly done it. How is it you make a determination as to what facts are worthy of being quoted in terms of their veracity?
I mean, that question is very similar to the question of when you're covering a gang shooting in Chicago, how do you do it? You know, I mean, it's not...
I don't say it's unique.
You know, some of it is just by years and years, and I've been doing this now for more than 30 years since I was in high school, of interviewing people and talking to them, you have an ability to judge kind of their reliability and their honesty, and it has to do with how specific they are. It has to do with whether you can tell in a situation like that, are people just repeating what the guy next to them said? Did they actually see something? Can they describe where they were standing? Would they have been able to see from where they were standing what they're saying they saw? Does what they sound like an authentic thing somebody might say, reflecting their own thoughts, or does it sound like something they're parroting? Does it sound like a cliche, a line, whatever? We generally, you know, we often give more credence to some like law enforcement official who seems to have conducted a variety of interviews and has maybe reviewed security tapes rather than some random eyewitness. And there have been lots of criminologist studies about eyewitnesses' own failings, just various reasons.
Yeah.
So, but it, you know, journalism is largely a judgment business, and one of the main judgments we make when we're talking to people is whether they're believable and credible. And sometimes we quote people who are not believable and credible on purpose because their lack of believability and credibility is relevant, and we have to explain that and put it into context. And sometimes we quote people saying outrageous things because it's outrageous that they said that.
So in this particular case, I am curious, given, I'm going to now make up the number, a half dozen people claim we're eyewitnesses, there were no knives. At what point do you decide that you're going to file the article, and is it that you seek, well, in other words, once the Israelis or once other people demonstrate that a knife was there, obviously that makes your business a little bit easier.
I mean, there's sort of two different things. If I was not reporting on what happened in this attack, it had been, I mean, I wasn't doing a news story about what happened in that attack, and even when I did write about it, that wasn't the point of what I was writing. The point was about the storytellers that they're telling themselves. So, but I think if I was trying to say, you know, was there a knife, then I would be much more interested in physical evidence of there having been a knife. There was a video of the guy running with the knife. There was the police picture of the knife next to the kid after he was shot. And the fact that the police, the witnesses were sort of denying that there was a knife would be about their denial and not about the facts of the situation. And in fact, that's what it was used for 2 weeks later also. It was very much about the idea that they were in denial or just telling themselves their own story. That was the point.
So let me just ask another question then about issues of headlines. Now, my understanding is that as a reporter, you're not really in charge of who writes the headlines, but a case that you did report that came under heavy criticism was one where three Palestinian perpetrators assassinated, stabbed to death an Israeli woman on the West Bank, and the headline initially read, "One Israeli and three Palestinians killed in the West Bank," as if all were, in quotes, equally victims. And later it was changed to, "Israeli woman and three Palestinian attackers killed in the West Bank." What I am curious about is, do you, in fact, this is now just a factual question, do you play any role in the headlines? And assuming you do not, because I'm going to presume most reporters don't control that, what do you think goes into the minds of headline writers? And clearly, they are desirous of bringing people in, but this has been one of the major critiques. I mean, look, another issue was, a few weeks ago, there was, of course, this very, from I think a Jewish perspective, infamous article about a debate as to whether the ancient temple stood on the Temple Mount. One of my colleagues, who's a professor at the University of North Carolina, Jodi Andrus, was quoted at great length in there, and then she was actually infuriated and wrote a letter into the Times where she said, you know, her remarks were, as it were, completely distorted, particularly by the headline, that what she had said was that if one wants to state what is the exact spot where the Holy of Holies, Kodesh HaKodeshim, stood, she said, that's a more difficult question to answer, but was there a Jewish temple that stood on this site? That, she said, is certainly uncontestable from any legitimate academic perspective. So I suppose the question then, just to go back to it, is, who does write these headlines, and how do you feel about it when you're a reporter, when that kind of headline appears?
I think the correction on the Temple Mount story did actually exceed the length of the story. So.
Yes.
It's a fine question. So the New York Times, the copy editors are in charge of writing the headlines, and they are highly skilled at this and highly professional and really the most talented copy editors in the world. There's some change going on in parts of the paper about that that would involve more reporters and also backfielders, which are kind of the people between the reporters and the copy desk and sort of what I'm becoming again in a headline writing process. Before I took this job, I had a very contentious meeting at at Malcolm Hanline's group,
the
Council of Presidents of Organizations of Major, whatever. Yeah. Anyway, and they were very upset about a photo placement, actually, back then, a very poor choice of a photo. And we had a big discussion about it, and I said to them, and they talked also about headlines at the time, and I said that I was going to try to really review photo choices and headlines when I was over there. And that turned out to be a really unrealistic thing to do, mostly because of the time difference. And in the example that you read, my only involvement of it was when I woke up at 6 a.m. and saw a bunch of complaints about it, I got a change. And I got a change to the first thing I could think of at 6 a.m., which was probably not the best possible headline, but it was better than the previous one. So what's going on with these headline writers? I mean, I don't think they're, you said something about trying to get a lot of readers, and I think I read something somewhere about, you know, trying to sell newspapers. Nobody in our newsroom thinks about selling newspapers. We do think about getting readers and keeping their attention, and we do think about, I think in a news story like this one was, you know, a succinct explanation of what's going on. It's not always so easy in a headline. And now that job has been complicated by things like SEO and social media needs and what headline will work best on mobile and what headline will work best on our website and what headline will work best in print. So the job has gotten a little more complicated, and they didn't do it well that day.
Yeah, I mean, look, a number of years ago, I wrote a few op-ed pieces for a paper that had a different editorial orientation than the New York Times. You may remember.
It hated Israel.
No, well, you may remember the late New York Sun, which had a slightly different orientation. And I had written a piece indicating why I did not participate in what was called, billed as an interfaith dialogue with President Ahmadinejad, because largely the op-ed piece stated that I didn't think that anyone was interested in dialogue there, but it was a propaganda opportunity. But the initial headline was, "Down with Interfaith Dialogue." And I
didn't like that.
Yeah, I mean, I called up immediately and said, while that was in the print, I said, I'm not opposed to interfaith dialogue. This just wasn't interfaith dialogue.
So our op-ed columnists, it turns out, do write their own headlines.
Huh. Oh, that's
interesting. And I don't know how many of you are readers of The Upshot, but it's a sort of more analytical and data-driven part of our website and our web report, or our whole report. And they are also experimenting more with writers writing their own headlines and with this kind of process that involves a lot of people in a kind of instant messaging way working on headlines. And we're thinking about doing something like that on the international desk as well.
We're going to take a break in a few moments, but there are two questions that I do want to ask you. Obviously, for many people here tonight, there is a feeling that the Times takes anti-Israel positions quite often. On the other hand, I'm going to make a presumption that you have other readers who think that your writing in particular and that of the Times in general takes an anti-Palestinian perspective. And this has to do with both, I suspect at times, the content of your writing, just as it does when Jewish readers or certain readers who have a certain vision of Israel who are Jewish read it. I suspect it comes both from the substance of what you write and a bit about your own background. So what I would like to hear about would be, could you just in a few moments tell us, you know, what your own background is? I know your father was a kosher butcher in Newton, Mass, and that you were raised at Camp Yavna, among other places, the same camp that Ezra Schwartz, Zichrono Livracha, attended. A bit about how does, in quotes, a nice Jewish girl who's born into this kind of family end up working as a reporter for the New York Times, covering Israel, what the impact of that might be. But then also then to talk about how is it that if we had a different kind of audience here, how do you think that Palestinians who have been critical or people who have a pro-Palestinian perspective, what are the types of critiques that they offer of your work?
That's a lot of questions.
Yes.
And I should say that I'm really happy to, both of my sisters who also grew up, the daughters of kosher butchers, have come from Chicago and Washington to be here tonight and to take me to dinner for my birthday afterwards. So thank you, Debbie and Julie.
It is her birthday today, so we'll sing to her later.
So I'm accused regularly of being a Hamas apologist and an IDF spokesperson. So it does depend on your perspective.
So you must be doing something right.
Well, I'm not a believer in the idea that if everybody thinks you're terrible, you must be doing something right. There is that school of thought. But I do think that what that tells you, it doesn't actually tell you anything about what I'm doing, but I think it does tell you a lot about the people making those assessments. I think that there is, on this beat, modest-sized and very well-organized and very loud community on both sides who have decided that undermining journalists is helpful to their cause. And, you know, there are some people who are very well-paid to do this, or organizations with a lot of money, I should say, to do this. And there are also some, you know, bloggers and tweeters who seem to do this 24/7. And I think that, I think it tells you much more about them than it does about me. There's not been, I think, really any analysis of me, my work, based on the values, the journalistic values that I'm trying to fulfill. There's a lot of assessment based on, you know, how does this fit with my pro or anti agenda. And that is fine for, you know, activists to have that agenda, but it does not serve our wider readership or my journalistic mandate at all. So I think that sort of that's what that's about. In terms of how I got here, I thanks largely to my sister Debbie, who's 3 years older than me and who is an editor now at the Washington Post and has been there for more than 25 years. She took a journalism class at Newton North High School when she was a senior. We had this, she told me it was the best class she'd ever taken. So I took it when I was a freshman. It was taught by a woman named Helen Smith, who's one of those teachers that you never forget. She was a total hard ass and taught me, it was basically the main journalism class I've ever taken. And I was pretty hooked then. And have been doing it pretty much ever since.
And you wrote at Yale, right?
I did. I was I majored in the Yale Daily News and was I was a reporter and an editor there for 3 years. And I did internships through college at newspapers and then went to work at the LA Times right out of college. And then Joyce Pernick, who I think is here, hired me at the New York Times in 1997. And her husband Max is here, who I played tennis with in order to get that job. There's a great story there that we will not spend the whole time on. And that's how I got there. I mean, before, I mean, I never imagined working at the New York Times. I never read the New York Times. My father, who had a meat business for many years in my childhood and still brings a good cut of meat with him wherever he goes. Never read the New York Times until I got hired there, and he immediately started subscribing to the New York Times, and he now is an obsessive reader of the New York Times, and it sort of fits him perfectly, even though he kind of never imagined that he could even be part of it. I first went to Israel in 1987 on USY pilgrimage. It was the second year of the Poland-Israel pilgrimage. I was on Group 5 with Jules Guten, and I immediately was taken with the journalistic aspects of the place, the combination of the layers of history that you could literally see in the soil in Jerusalem, and the fact that it was the most important place for the world's three major religions and that people were fighting about it was the stuff of journalistic fantasies. And I only went back one other time before moving there in 1993 with my family. But I always kind of had in my mind that, you know, maybe someday I could go work there. And then I really shelved that idea. My life sort of moved on. I did national and politics and crime and punishment, and I just wasn't really thinking about being a foreign correspondent. I had kids. I didn't think it was going to happen. And then the opportunity came up, and I said, this is the hardest thing I could think of to do.
So how does it feel to be leaving now, and how do you feel about your new job coming up?
It's a mix. I mean, it happened very fast. We thought we were going to stay there till the summer, and then they asked me to come back earlier. So we're in a whirlwind of saying goodbye to people and finishing up stories and trying to find a place to live and trying to find schools for our kids. So it's a little crazy. But I, you know, when I took the job, I took it because I thought it was the hardest thing I could think of to do. You just heard me say that. And it's turned out to be much, much more difficult than I could ever have imagined. We also, when we talked about it, my husband and I, we thought, well, you know, when we're in our rocking chairs in the nursing home, will we wish we had 4 more years in Brooklyn, or will we be glad to have gone? And we knew immediately we'd be glad to have gone. I think those two things are going to stay with me. Those things are true. I'm glad we were there. I've learned a ton. But it's going to take a while to process exactly what it was all about for us.
Fair enough. I want to thank you for everything. We're very grateful to you for reporting on it. We wish you a happy birthday. And very good luck in your new position.
So thanks so much, Rabbi.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. and please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to Jim. To Jim, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.